They are giants traveling our shores, enduring the longest migration of any mammal. Gray whales were almost extinct, then bounced back and thrived. But recently, they began to disappear again by the thousands. Join the Cousteau team as it investigates the obstacles this unique whale faces, from Baja to the Arctic. It's Jean-Michel Cousteau, Ocean Adventures.
This is summer in the Arctic, where thousands of gray whales are now arriving. It marks the end of a long migration by the whales we drove to extinction in the Atlantic, then managed to save in the Pacific. The Cousteau team has come to the top of the world to see what these Arctic waters can reveal about this marathon whale. Gray whales have fought to exist, but recently, one-third of their entire population mysteriously disappeared. The team will investigate why, starting with what we think we know about gray whales.
Unbelievable. That was pretty.
They migrate 12,000 miles round trip from here to Baja, 7 months without food. Finally, the famished whales return for a feast found only here, or so we think. They're the only whales that feed on the ocean floor, and they seem to always feed on the right side. In the Arctic summer, the sun shines 24 hours a day, fueling tiny plants for tiny animals on which the whales feed. It's a feeding ground the size of Switzerland.
Nice foggy day to make a dive in the Arctic.
To get a first-hand look at the whales' food, the team will collect samples of mud from the ocean floor.
I'm gonna take 4 core samples off there, all right? So once you get out, you bury them in the mud in the bottom, 1 cap on each end, stick them back in the bag. Do all four different areas.
Plowing the muddy bottom to feed, gray whales create underwater trenches and alter the environment more than any animal except the elephant. The water is near freezing. Visibility underwater will be zero. Don Santee sits this one out.
Yeah, good day for an old beach party. Just me and my friends, the polar bears.
Well, it was black and it was black. You could feel the dips in the bottom, though.
Big trenches with whales.
Were there?
Right yeah. There, so we were in the right spot. Whoa, there it goes.
Yeah. Got it.
Now that is an amphipod. That's what I thought we would see up here.
A lot of work to get a good-sized meal out there.
And the whales need a ton a day.
Thanks a lot for getting rid of the sediment.
Yeah.
Because I have some really cool organisms here.
You have these huge gray whales feeding on these little critters.
5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. 10 amphipods, so amphipods were the
dominant species.
The majority of the actual biomass in that sample. Yeah. The amphipods, which are the known main food of the gray whales, will eat anything. Gray whales have no teeth. Their bottom jaw is just gums, but all along the top jaw, they grow plates of what's called baleen. Baleen is just like fingernail, made of the same material, keratin. These are the baleen plates. There's one right here, and then another one, and another one, and another one, all stacked up, hundreds of them.
And that's the outside.
That's right. And when they feed and they bring in large mouths full of water, and then they close their mouth, and they use their tongue to squeeze the water out through the baleen. these types of critters right here, our amphipod would land on there. And the very last part of feeding is that when this material is stuck to the baleen and the water is out, then the gray whale uses its tongue to lick off the critters.
Could the sudden disappearance of a third of gray whales in 2 years be linked to their food source? Or could it be obstacles along their migration? To find out, the Cousteau team will meet the whales at the southern end of their migration and then follow them back to the Arctic, along the only coastline in the world where they continue to thrive. It begins a world away where males, females, young and old come to mate and give birth, and maybe just to play, in the lagoons of Baja, Mexico. 14 crew members aboard the research vessel Beauport have a busy 3-week expedition ahead. Magdalena Bay is where they will begin to track the whales in protected shallow waters, more suited to gray whales than to the ship.
You're right now being pointed, this is where I was in 3 feet of water.
What did he say, he was in 3 feet of water?
Yeah. The Beauport obstacle course.
15 feet.
That could be a final anchoring spot, but see how it looks on your chart.
Yeah, that looks good, Doug. There's a whale, too. Jeez, that's a good... Oh, everything's happening at once.
So you ready to go diving?
Yeah, man. Get the water.
Although it is believed that the gray whales only feed in the Arctic, whales are spotted off a shallow sandbar in what looks like feeding behavior. Matt Ferraro and Blair Mott will enter these nursery waters to check it out.
Hey, I'm looking forward to getting the water at those whales.
They find a seafloor without food for whales, confirming the whales are not here to feed. Matt then discovers a patch of whale skin, a clue to the true activity going on here. Gray whales can be infested with up to a ton of parasites attached to the skin. This is a rubbing beach where the whales can at last scratch. On the shallow sandbars, the sea breaks into waves, and the whales have even discovered how to body surf. Baja may be more than a whale nursery. It may also be a spa. In these tranquil lagoons, gray whales were almost hunted to extinction, but 70 years ago were protected from whaling. Don travels north to San Ignacio Lagoon, where protection has led to the only place in the world where any whales regularly approach people.
Ready to go?
Well, before to go, are you gonna give him a bracelet?
Oh.
And this you have to wear this, because that means that you are in a natural protected area in Mexico.
How long have you been a panga driver here?
This is my 23rd season driving boats in whale watching.
What will we see when we go out there today?
Breaching, spy hoppings, matings, many different behaviors.
Oh, good.
In 1972, normally elusive gray whales suddenly turned friendly and began to approach boats.
There's her eye.
And they haven't stopped.
Yeah, she's moving the boat a bit with her nose. There seems to be a lot of power in her head. She's just moving the bow of our boat around with her head.
Amazingly, the mothers bring their babies.
Baby?
That was nice eye.
Yeah, there's the eye.
Nursing on milk that is 50% fat, a calf will double its weight before reaching the Arctic. 7 months after birth, it will part from its mother and have to fend for itself.
Well, they're pretty accommodating, huh? They were right there with us. They didn't mind us at all. And the baby was just playing, just laying there playing.
But even in these idyllic waters, a protected World Heritage Site, nothing can be taken for granted. San Ignacio was recently threatened when a major corporation and the Mexican government wanted a massive salt mine project to improve the economy. Cousteau and others objected.
Good environmental policy, 100% of the time, is identical to good economic policy. What the promoters of this project are saying when they're talking about good economy, they're talking about treating the planet as if it were a business in liquidation, converting our natural resources to cash as fast as possible, and having a few years of pollution-based prosperity. And of course, that can generate an instantaneous cash flow and the illusion of a prosperous economy, but our children will pay for our joyride.
Efforts to stop the salt mine were successful, and for now, the lagoons remain safe. Once the whales leave for the Arctic, they travel hidden below the surface, except to breathe. So the team welcomes experts in satellite tagging to follow the whales from space.
Hey, hey!
How you doing?
Ready to tag some whales?
Oh, yeah. Yep.
Good, good.
Are they close by, or?
That's what we need to sit down and talk about.
Okay, so we're here, so we're and then you're wanting to...
Whales, they move with the tide. High tide is at 6:30, something like that, mm-hmm. in the morning. So we have to be ready very early.
Designed not to harm the whale, the tags are challenging to attach and unpredictable as to how long they will stay in place.
We, from scratch, designed the transmitter, build the transmitter. The antenna has to be exposed, and you have to be able to contact the satellite. Doing that three times or more within a 10-minute window allows the satellite to determine the latitude, longitude of the whale. The steel ring, stainless steel ring, keeps it from penetrating into the whale on the surface tissue. I typically like to shoot 30 to 45 degree angle to the body. I get some leeway by shooting them lengthwise. So if I make an error because of the waves, it's not as critical.
But ideally you want it a little bit higher, but it didn't go in too deep though, right?
Deploy well.
There they are, 1 o'clock.
Okay.
Neutral, neutral, neutral!
Jean-Michel.
John, is that you?
Hey, I got a little update.
What's going on?
We had two fantastic days of tagging here. We've tagged four whales.
Well, I'm very pleased, and I guess that now that the scientists have done their job, we're going to be able to track them and see how much trouble they find along the way. Thank you to all, and we'll be in touch tomorrow. Bye now.
Bye.
All right.
Yeah, that's it.
Plotted out already?
Yeah, look at this. These are the first two whales that we tagged. These here are the GPS coordinates from the Argo satellite.
Oh, wow.
Here's the 10th
wow.
GPS, so it's well, basically...
That whale's on its way north.
It's on its way north, so we should probably start moving ourselves.
Mothers and calves are the last whales to leave the lagoons, waiting for the calves to gain strength. They face thousands of miles ahead, swimming without stopping. The crew continues to monitor satellite signals with backup from short-range VHF. But within days, only one signal remains strong as the ship heads north. Reaches San Diego, a threshold to the densely populated California coastline. All tags stop transmitting, possibly rubbed off by the calves or on the sandy bottom. The team must now proceed with their backup plan, which is to follow the whales the hard way, connecting with experts, waiting and watching. The mother whales will hide going north, seeking protection for their calves in the contours of the coastline. There is an entire industry, though, dedicated to finding them. Worldwide, whale watching is a $1 billion business in 90 countries, with over 9 million people learning about whales.
How big do you think it is, the gray whale?
20.
That's a pretty good guess.
45 feet long.
Oh.
So that's a pretty big one. And the baby's around 12 feet. Is that right, Matt?
But the gray whale has evolved to hide. South of Los Angeles, the team finds experts at watching.
This is the ACSLA, American Cetacean Society, Gray Whale Census and Behavior Project. We'll be out here on the cliffs of Palos Verdes from December 1st through about May 15th, depending upon how long the whales are coming through. We're the only full season gray whale census in the world. Also the only gray whale census staffed entirely by experienced volunteers. We work very carefully with the National Marine Fisheries Service, and they do the official census up in Central California to actually determine how many gray whales there are. We work together and look at our trends and see how closely they match. The two key things are the timing of the migration. Are they on time the way we'd expect? Are they early or late, which could reflect a problem with the environment or feeding? And also, how many calves are surviving? And this year we're seeing healthy whales, fat whales, lots of calves, which really makes us feel that everything's going just fine.
I noticed that there's some oil rigs that are inside Long Beach Harbor, and there's plenty of oil rigs up in the Santa Barbara area. Are those impacting the whales at all?
Well, we have those out here too, and I would have thought that the oil rigs might scare whales away because of the noise they make, but gray whales tend to torque their migration to actually go through oil rig lines, so I think they may actually use them as a point of navigation.
Oh, really? Yeah, well, we use the oil rigs for navigation to get back and forth the islands too, so I guess we're as smart as whales then.
Swimming constantly, the whales cover up to 80 miles a day. As they pass Piedras Blancas, south of Big Sur, they are again being counted.
What's special about this site is that the cows and calves will just come in right next to us here. You could hit them with a potato as they go by, they're so close. In 94, we took gray whales off the endangered species list. So my agency, the National Marine Fisheries Service, was obligated to be sure we were making the right decision. The first year, we had a good solid count of calves. The next year, it kind of tanked out, and we had no idea why. So we've been continuing the counts, and we found that there are really wide fluctuations in reproduction that we think are linked to environmental conditions in the Arctic. The adult females that are calving, they're going through this long migration, lactation, and then another long migration without feeding. So physiologically, that's pretty tough. Now this is a vertical photograph of a gray whale cow-calf pair. And you can see how sleek this female looks. I mean, she's really kind of narrow looking. And if you looked at this same animal when she was migrating southbound in December or January, I mean, they're just real fat and robust. And naturally, she's got a calf inside of her, so that makes her shape wide also. So we photograph southbound animals, see how wide they are relative to their length. Then we also look at northbound animals with calves. By doing this, we can compare year after year after year. And what we found was, in 1999 and 2000, when we had real bad years, that overall gray whales were much thinner than they were in good years. So that allowed us to think that what happened in those years was related to nutrition.
So controlled at the feeding station.
That's right. What's important to gray whales is what happens in the Arctic. That's where they feed.
But in Monterey, California, it's killer whales that have come to feed, and they've been waiting. Nancy Black is an expert on killer whales, and her research links their high numbers in the area to the seasonal presence of gray whale calves. Jean-Michel and his team have come here to better understand and possibly witness the most intense natural obstacle that gray whales must encounter.
Okay, what do you guys think? Killer whales or gray whales? Where do you want to go?
You mean we're not together?
No.
Let's go for gray whales.
Okay, pass down.
Right,
here we are, under the surface. Here we go. That's a baby. That's the baby.
More calves have been counted this year than ever before, perhaps rebounding from the decline of 1999 and 2000. But as research shows, more calves also means more killer whales.
Good
morning. Hi, guys. If you could come alongside this way.
The gray whales are a really important food source for the killer whales, especially at this time of year, because one gray whale calf could feed up to maybe 20 to 30 different killer whales. they might eat a lot in a short period of time, and then after, you know, the gray whale season, then they're looking for sea lions or dolphins or other animals. So, you know, it's probably a healthy thing for them to feed so much on all these gray whales right now. It's an important thing for their culture to teach their calves how to hunt these large whales, because it's pretty difficult. They have to coordinate with each other, and mostly the adult females are involved. And while the females are attacking the gray whales, the calves are right in there observing what's going on, and they'll need to do that for the future. So it's been a natural thing of the killer whales and the gray whale interaction, probably for, you know, thousands of years.
Okay, we're gonna go to the other side of the grid.
So you're taking us to your favorite whaling spot.
Yeah, we'll head across the main of the canyon.
We want to see action.
Okay.
Lots of action.
When the gray whales leave Point Pinos, which is the southern end of Monterey Bay, before that they're hugging the coastline, traveling right outside the kelp beds of the shoreline. But when they get to that point, then they have to start crossing Monterey Bay. Very few of them take the long way around, so they tend to take the route that goes across the bay and puts them over the canyon. And the killer whales come in to patrol the canyon. That's how they find the gray whales over the deep water, because we think they're listening for the gray whales.
Does it appear they're taking a shortcut?
It looks like they are going to cut across the bay. They're not going to go inside.
Maybe a big mistake.
These whales have lost the safety of the shore as they enter deep waters. The Cousteau team struggles to track the elusive whales and their progress.
Good. Do we have a heading on that whale?
Trying to move up there for you.
Good boy. Cameramen are actually Don's favorite.
Get a little closer. Get a little farther away. Go a little faster. Go a little slower. You know, can you make the sun go away? Can you make the sun come out? Okay, Matt, I need to. Can't see anything now.
Okay, well, neither can I. We got killer whales that are 3 o'clock right here.
Okay, you got 1 o'clock. We got something. 1 o'clock, but that's.
The team spots an attack, an event rarely witnessed, even by researchers.
Yeah, a little calf.
Where's mom?
It will be a life or death fight for the calf as its mother tries to defend it, even coming to the boat for protection.
And the mother does all she can to protect her calves. The mother tries to keep moving towards shore while the attack is going on, because if she gets close enough to shore, then they can escape in the surf line or the kelp. That one just jumped on top of the calf. When they do that, they're trying to hold it under to drown it. And then the other killer whales, I think there's about 12 in the group there, kind of circle around, and the young ones are learning how to hunt as well.
Going underneath us.
Underneath this guy.
One of their best strategies is trying to separate the mother gray whale from its calf, and then they can really focus on the calf, bashing the calf from the underside. When they do that, a lot of it causes kind of internal injury, and the killer whales will surround it, and one will come from underneath, the other's from the side, another from the front. The calf is continually rolling. That's their best way to keep the killer whales from hanging on to their pectoral fins or their tail flukes, is to continue rolling as much as they can.